Hello everybody and welcome to my talks. This is the start of the fourth talk, which I have called Setting Up Your Practice, and this involves my take on how to bring it all together and how to go about thinking about starting your own practice. Now, right, here's the thing. If you become a therapist, there are two quite separate areas that need to be focused on. One is a specific skill set, and the second is a knowledge base. Now, as you develop and progress, both will develop in their own ways. but they are separate entities, and I'll deal with them separately. Let's look at the skill set. As I've said, the skills are essentially in listening to the client, connecting with the client, and communicating with the client. And I've covered these in the client-centered therapy bits that have gone before. The next thing that is really important, the skill, is how to take a case history. And I'll be going over that, of how to practice and how to go about it. Because this is one of the most critical skills that you need. In fact, if you don't have this, you can't do anything else, taking a case history. And then being able to summarize the case history. So after speaking to somebody for an hour or so, you need to be able to summarize all the main points in a succinct, precise, and in a precise and succinct manner, so that you can write the whole precis of the summary in not more than one or two paragraphs. That's a key skill. The next bit of the skill set is really developing the right IT skills to do this kind of work. So how do you set up Zoom? How do you arrange all the IT bits? So you, most people already have the skills that do Skype, Zoom, FaceTime, whatever it might be. So, however, what I do want to, give my thoughts on how you should organize your virtual office space. Because remember, this is a course about how to develop a skill or how to develop a business online. So wherever you are, it might be a corner of your home that you dedicate to an office space. I'll tell you how to set this up to have the right visual impact. So I'll cover that. One also obviously needs to look at practical financial and business organization of this venture. And one of the good things about this kind of venture, it is very low cost. Because you're working at home, you do not have to rent premises, things like this. All your skills are really your personal skills and having good audio-visual contact with your patient through a computer, which is again something you probably have already, or it's very cheap. And another aspect of the skill of being a successful therapist is to be able to set boundaries, choose your workload, choose your clients, choose what you want to do. So you need to be able to direct your career and control the agenda. That is really important. So you are in control, although you are helping people. Unless you look after yourself, you will never be able to help many people. So the ability to control the agenda, set boundaries, and choose your workload and actually and do the business bits, like asking clients for payment, etc., is a critical skill if you are to survive. So that's the skill set. Let's look at the basis of the knowledge base. Now, I have divided the knowledge base into two very separate entities. One is now this is this particular talk is about my method. It's about the way I see the world, right? Now, I'm not a psychotherapist by training. I'm a medical doctor by training, primary care physician, if you like, with an experience of also psychiatry and things like this. So I come from that kind of background. And yet I have appear to have invented a system of training psychotherapists. But in my view, if a psychotherapy, if somebody wishes to train along the lines I suggest, it is a critical faculty to get a very good understanding of conventional medicine and the conventional care healthcare system. So basically, like in my case, people think of me as some kind of alternative practitioner. I'm not. I'm a conventional doctor. I think, actually, curiously enough, along conventional lines. However, I'm open to a variety of therapy solutions and therapy options and whatnot, which I use as an adjunct to my basic medical skills or basic medical thinking and so forth. So anybody that works along the system I recommend has to develop a very good understanding of conventional medicine and the conventional healthcare system. And in a subsequent talk, I'm going to tell you exactly how to do this very easily. In addition to knowing about conventional medicine, you need to have a very good and evolving knowledge. The word evolving is important, of approaches to therapy that are outside the medical mainstream, because this is a huge field and keeps growing all the time. And every day, even me, I find new things that I didn't know about before. So it is something that so if I can infect you with something, it's infecting you with with curiosity to learn more and more, and you never stop learning. So I'll tell you how to go about understanding the alternative, if you like. When you can know both of these, you can combine them in some sort of way. And in this way, so although the scope of my method doesn't give you an accredited degree or something, it will give you a curious and very unique type of knowledge, which you should be able to use to good effect, I think. And I insist on the good understanding of conventional medicine and the conventional healthcare system, as without this, in my view, you will be very, you'll be, if you don't have this or are just alternative, you'll be of very little use to society. That's my view anyway. So I'll come to that in a bit. Now, so if you, as a therapist, you've got a skill set and you've got a knowledge base, and this will allow you to develop your own bespoke management strategy to suit the individual client that is sitting in front of you, or rather not sitting in front of you, on the computer in front of you, shall we say. Now, let's go over what I have already discussed in previous talks. I've already stated that about taking a case history and the first consultation, and you should be able to learn to take a brief, quick, and quite holistic case history very quickly. And this is usually free, okay? So your first consultation with a client should normally be free. And then after that, the client and therapist can decide whether they are suited to work with each other. And there should always be a cooling period involved so that hasty decisions are not taken, and if the client does decide to commit, they actually stay committed. Now, the second consultation, which is a paid for consultation, is when you personally sit and do all the anxiety, depression, and stress questionnaires. And so that the third consultation, which is when you can sit back, you've got the case history, you've got the questionnaires, you are in a very good position now to develop a summary. Right, you can summarize the case, say, based on all the information I have gathered, these are the main points of the case, and I can condense them into two or three paragraphs, say, of all the issues, the main issues involved, and in a hierarchy of issues. These are the most immediate, these are less immediate, these are long term, and can be kicked into the long grass for the minute. Now, the third consultation with your client is when you prepare a summary, you discuss this summary with the patient, and you've written out a summary, and do they agree with it? It's quite important to carry your client with you. So, for example, if you do a case summary, do they agree with it? If they don't, why don't they disagree? What do they feel you have missed out? It is really, really important to develop a deep understanding between client and therapist of what is there. So they agree. So you have to form a joint agreement with the client of what it is that is troubling the client. And then you have to discuss with the client, what do you plan to do? How do you plan to go about it? So you have to be able to agree with the client realistic goals. What are realistic goals in the situation? You can't sort out somebody's life or solve big problems. Focus on things that can be done, and in broad outline how you're going to do them. So you need to agree a summary. You need to agree a realistic goals that can be, and choose a realistic time framework, which is 3 to 6 months. So this is quite important, that at the end of 3 to 4 months, they can have a redoing of the questionnaires, and they can see to what extent they have become better as a result of their contact with the therapist. And really, the course of therapy in this primary course should never be more than 6 months. So at the end of 6 months, you tell the client, look, I've done everything I can do for you, and you'll have to, we can see each other from time to time, but on a kind of need to do basis. But that's how the thing will be done henceforward. So this is a very good way of arranging it. So you can do your diary, you can do your scheduling and everything like this. So having a clear cut, and this is very important for the client, is, in other words, they have to commit time and they have to commit money to the project, and they have to be, nobody likes to enter an open-ended contract. They like to know, how can I evaluate, what are my get-out clauses, is this working for me, and so forth. So it has to work for both parties. It has to work for the client, and it has to work for the therapy. But remember, put the client first. Okay, the next topic I'm going to talk about is developing the right skills. So this is really divided into maybe four parts. The first is listening and interpersonal skills. Now, I've gone into all of this in some detail in the talks, but how do you learn this? Three things come to mind immediately. One thing is you need to practice listening to people without interrupting. This is actually quite hard, okay? But just practicing and seeing what happens, how difficult it actually is. The next thing is co-counseling. There's a little chapter of it in my book. And co-counseling is a method where people that want a career of this kind can help each other by practicing certain types of skills. So simply Google it and or whatever and find out how to use it if you feel that that's appropriate. The third thing is actually look up resources on developing counseling skills. There are lots of books and lots of resources that teach people how to become listeners, counselors, and the interpersonal skills involved with that. The next thing I want to talk about is how do you take a case history, which is actually a core skill. The answer to this is practice, practice, and practice, and practice some more. To start with, now I have already in my case history taking, I've already elaborated on how you should take a case history, so you can make your own notes from that. But how do you start? To start with, I would suggest doing 12 case histories from friends and family. These are people that want to help you, and it's fine if they want to make up diseases, do different kinds of things, and you can have a laugh. But the art is to learn to talk to them, listen to what they have to say, and learn to document it. So it is practice. So it doesn't matter who it is. You start with friends and family. But simply learn to ask questions and see what is said and document what is said. So that's the first way to do it, 12 cases from friends and family. Once you've done that, you've got a certain basic core skill already. You then find about 12 people that are strangers to you, that understand that you are just a student trying out this technique, and they get to talk to somebody or get counseling or something like this for free, on the understanding that that they are your, you know, guinea pigs to study how to take case histories and so forth. So, and you can probably find this from your Facebook or ask for local people and things like this, and arrange to speak to them. So by the time you have done these 24 cases, you will already have developed a level of skill in talking and getting case histories taken. Now, the next thing you need to do, while you're doing this, you need to somehow find, in my opinion, somebody to whom you can recount a case history and recount a summary. Some medical person, preferably. Ideally, a doctor who is quite happy to listen to what you have to say, take a case history and help you with that kind of thing. It's completely doable, but you need to make that arrangement. And if you have, for example, a doctor that is listening to you, and there comes a point where they say, hey, that's great, you know, you really got it, you've nailed it, that's when you know you've made it, that's when you're there, okay? So that's about taking case histories, and this is a case of practicing and learning to recount it to people that can listen to it and affirm the skill. The next bit I want to discuss is something called your virtual office setup. Now, as a therapist, you're going to be working completely online, and it is, I can't tell you how critical it is to have your office space and your appearance and everything like that just exactly so. Now, remember that first impressions count. And if a client initially sees somebody with a whole bookcases and bookcases of books behind them, it suggests that it's a very busy mind. It won't it's not conducive to a therapist client therapist relationship. Also, you need to have appropriate props behind you that are not to do with sporting trophies or friends, you know, family photographs or things like this. So in my mind, the ideal thing that somebody should see on their screen is you as a therapist, and you should remember that you should be smartly dressed at all times, so that somebody that looks at you based on your appearance and dress, they think they're speaking to a professional in their mind. Now, you should definitely have at least one bookcase behind you, but it should not be large. it should never occupy more than 1/4 of the space of the background. So it should be there, suggesting that you are knowledgeable, but you have a lot of empty space behind you. That is a pot plant is helpful, and a comforting kind of landscape or seascape picture or something like this in the background. The rest is a plain background, and there's you. So this kind of scene gives a client a lot of comfort to offload, open, and things like this. So remember this. And so you can always have a notice board behind the computer screen with all the questions and your notes and things, so that you can see your notes without the client being aware that you are actually, you've got your aid memoirs and props behind you. What they see is what is behind the, you know, what is your background. And also during your work, now audio, good audio visuals are really important. So consider the use of a lapel microphone rather than using an ordinary webcam. So that's important. The voice is very important. And also, when you start to work, you need to plan your things so you avoid foreseeable interruptions in your work, particularly by kids and things like this. But if you have pets at home, that's absolutely fine. Pets are always comforting to clients that look at a therapist with a pet. That's absolutely fine. So that's a little bit of the virtual office setup. And the last thing I want to tackle in this little page is developing the right business skills. So obviously you need to get advice on the business and financial skills you need to set up as a kind of sole trader, probably. And you need to get appropriate legal advice, as you will be, if you follow my methods and things like this, you will be starting off without any obvious qualifications. But if a legal person says, oh, you can't do that, you need this, look at the law very carefully and challenge them. And see what can be done. I'll just give you a little example. For example, I came across a lady from North Carolina that was completing a Reiki course. And she said, oh, in North Carolina, you need to be a certified healer to practice healing. I said, really? In what way is the state of North Carolina in a position to certify a healer? The answer to this is probably that you need to register a business where a thing can claim tax, but the state itself cannot legislate on the validity of particular qualifications. That's in my opinion. But this needs to this is a thing that needs to be legally checked up. For example, it is entirely possible for you to set up a business doing fortune telling or tarot cards or whatever it is in your front room. As long as you're declaring that as a business on which you pay tax, I suppose it's all right. But you need to check the legal status and find ways around any hurdles that might appear. There'll always be ways to do it. And if you do set up a website, please keep it basic. I think the important thing is that your clientele should come to you through word of mouth rather than any grand website or something like this. It should be quite basic. And focus on being really good at what you do. And I believe that if people don't put the cart before the horse, but really aspire to be very good at what they do, then and allow their practice to grow organically. I've seen a lot of people, I know a few therapists and people like this, who never advertise at all, yet they have waiting lists for people that want to see them. So if you're good at what you do, the universe will often arrange things so that your ventures and things are successful. And it's absolutely, you should be using social media in this day and age to develop, so people know what you're doing. So that's it for this page. I now come to the topic of developing one's knowledge base. Now, as I've said before, I cannot emphasize enough that for in my view, for a therapist to be really useful to a client, the therapist has to have a very good knowledge of conventional medicine and therapy and things like this. And this has a number of facets to it, which I will go into in detail, because one really needs to know how the present system operates and what are the things. One of the things that I've come across in my work as a doctor specializing in knowledge about complementary therapies is that the majority of complementary therapies that I have personally come across have quite a poor knowledge of how doctors think and work, and this is not really conducive to a dialogue with conventional doctors. So one of the things about I'll come to the how to do it in a minute, but assuming that a therapist has a good comes to have a good working knowledge of conventional medicine, as a therapist, the client will perceive you as somebody that knows a lot about medicine, perceives you, it's like having a doctor in the family. So the client will ask you about various things, and often they are uncertain about things, about other medical issues, maybe health issues to do with their diabetes, hypertension, different kinds of, you know, statins they might be on or different kinds of medications. And you're in a position to do particular research on the matter or play the role of an extremely well-informed person on matters of medical, on medical matters. And if you're able to do this, your client will be not only very impressed, but they will stick to you because, you know, having somebody that can guide them through the maze of medical issues is an extremely valuable thing. As I said, like having a doctor in the family, and they are likely to stick to you like glue, and you're going to have a client for life, which is good. Also, if you understand conventional medicine, depending on circumstances, you will be able to communicate effectively with the medical profession. And if for example, your patient praises you to the skies and says, "What a good job you have done," or you may be able to speak to doctors in a way, in a manner that they understand, and they themselves will refer patients to you or ask their patients to self-refer to you and see you as a private patient, for example, or something like this. So don't be surprised if you're good at what you do and you can communicate in the language they understand. So this is something about that. Now, how do you go about it? To start with, like my two Bibles in medicine are, one is the Oxford Handbook of General Practice. Now, this is a little handbook with thin pages, 1,000 pages in this, of which about over 900 are devoted to all topics within medicine, and about 50 to 75 pages are about psychiatry or mental health, okay? So this shows you that within the medical syllabus, mental health is like 10% of the syllabus. 90% is about everything else. So to start with, a therapist should be able to read this book from cover to cover. All the topics not to do with mental health, skim them over and try and work out. There's a lot of medical jargon here. Blood tests and things like this. Be curious to find out how to read it. It's a bit like discovering, for example, if your job is, if you get a job in a tech industry, like selling a tech industry, then your job is to understand tech language, be able to read tech magazines and things like this and appraise and evaluate them, or in order for you to market or sell things to clients, that you need to know all the specifications and different kinds of things that different things have. if you are to effectively sell things. It's not different from medicine. A certain amount of effort is needed to initially read through the thing, but as you get through, what does this word mean? What does that term mean? So you need to look it up. You need to be able to ask somebody. Ultimately, you need to be able to make sense of it. And it's quite possible for a lay person to read a medical book and get the gist of what is required. Now, for general practitioners such as myself, this book gives each condition, it's presented as a kind of synopsis of what the treatments are and things like this. So if I pick up this book, I'll immediately be able to make sense of different kinds of things. So the next book that has to be mastered is, certainly in Britain, is the British National Formulary, which contains all the current drugs that are in existence, all their things. So how do you use this? For example, so my advice is for a therapist to peruse all the medical knowledge to start with, get a sense of it, and read the part on psychiatry and mental health word by word, cover to cover. So you have to be an expert in psychiatry and become very well informed about everything else. Now, how do you do this? For example, you actually, each time a client has an issue, say I've got high blood pressure or I'm on this drug, find out details of the drug, what dose they're on, look it up, read the book, read the things, and this way you'll build up a picture. This is how medical students actually learn. They learn from real cases. For example, they go into the ward and there's a lady with rheumatoid arthritis that there is on the bed. They are told to take a case history of that person, and they're meant to go home and read up about it. So if you read up about something that is that you've got on your plate at the moment, that's how you learn. And this is an evolving thing. So you do need to make an effort to find out about how to understand conventional medicine, read up about it. So at the end of the day, you should be able to read a medical article, you should be able to read a medical book and make sense of it in exactly the way that people that deal with medical journalism or whatever have to. It's part of their job requirement. So make that a habit. Now, so there are three books in order to do with my kind of course or what I'm teaching. One is Oxford Handbook Book of General Practice. The second is the British National Formulary. And the third is my book on mental health. So these are the three books. Now, for people in America, you can get equivalents of the British National Formulary. For example, there can be the American Medical Formulary available in some form. And instead of the Oxford Handbook of General Practice, there's bound to be an equivalent edition of the Handbook for Primary Care Physicians and a Handbook of for Psychiatry. So as long as you are able to make that effort, that should work. And whatever books you get, they don't need to be the very latest, but they should not be more than 5 years old, because knowledge doesn't change that often. So books that are 5 to 5 years old are pretty much up to date in medicine, I think, for this kind of job. Now, I do need to say something about communicating with doctors. Now, assuming that a therapist does actually get this type of knowledge under his or her belt, as it were. Now, referring a patient to a doctor, you might see a client with a psychological issue and say, actually, do you know what? You need to see a doctor and get medication. Now, it's perfectly all right to write to the doctor or contact them, but keep a referral letter very simple. Dear Dr. So-and-so, I understand that this is a patient. I'm seeing this person as a holistic therapist, and I do believe that the person needs to come and see you for medical management of their problem. Keep a referral letter to a doctor extremely simple, and do not give any history of the things that you have done. Keep your medical history to yourself, and never ever tell a doctor what to do. That puts them off, because they like to evaluate the patient and act as they think fit. So as long as you observe these rules, there's no problem in writing a referral letter to about a patient. And if the doctor, you know, the patient says this person has helped me very much, etc., you might well receive a letter back from the doctor, thank you for referring, this is what I'm doing, and they might, if they think you're very good, they might actually solicit your details to give to pass on to colleagues and things like this as somebody that's very good. So don't be surprised. The other thing about having this knowledge is to prep your client for their doctor's appointment. Now, as a practicing physician for so many years and having worked as advising people about medical problems more recently, one of the key things that I have found useful is that is to prepare patients to clear their agendas with doctors. For example, let me give you a simple example. Say suppose a person goes to a doctor with a bad back pain or something like this. And if, for example, they say to the doctor, oh, doctor, do you know what? I feel very bad about my bad back. It's getting me down. So then you present a complex agenda to the doctor. Are they coming to me about their back pain, or are they coming to me about feeling down or low? And so time is wasted sorting out these agendas. So it's really important for you to prep your client before they see their doctor so that the agendas are clear, so that they have their questions written down, and they need to be questions that a doctor can answer, like, by the way, I have this, what are the options I've got, things like this. And don't confuse emotional agendas with physical symptoms. So, for example, with back pain, say, I have got this back pain, this is where it hurts and things like this, what do you think I should do about it? So the doctor can examine and make a decision and refer, do whatever tests and things like this. So that's a very clear agenda. On a separate occasion, having nothing to do with the back pain, go back and say, look, I've got this chronic back pain and it's I'm feeling very down about it. Do you think I should be on a medication to help me and things like this? Then the doctor can deal with that. So it's important to clarify different agendas and not to mix them up. If a patient wants to get the best result from a doctor, so that is actually quite important. And so one of the things to keep in mind is that as you get a client, as you get to know them and they get, find out exact details of their medication, what is on, make actual notes of it, look it up. And for example, if a client, they might be seeing you for a psychological matter, but by the way, they say, oh, I've been to see my doctor about my diabetes and they've changed my medication. Oh yes, really? What exactly have they changed? To what and what dose? So the client will be very impressed with you if you are following up their medical story as well. Oh, this drug, I've got it in my notes that you were on 40 milligrams of, say, atorvastatin for cholesterol or something like this. Oh, yes, and the doctor said, no, I'm going to put you on it. Oh, which one was it and what dose, and look it up and make notes about it. So this is actually very, this not only keeps you as somebody that is involved with the other, with the physical illness of the client, but it is, yeah, the client will feel very reassured that you're taking an interest as well, and appear to be knowledgeable on the subject. So that can will serve you as a therapist in very good stead, I think. And it's important to practice reading medical books, magazines, looking through stuff and becoming familiar with all sorts of stuff like this. So that's the end of this bit of developing the medical side of the knowledge base, and in the next part I'll develop the other sides. Okay, this is the last slide to do with this part of the talk, and it is really about developing one's knowledge base. I've already covered in the last slide about developing a knowledge base about conventional medicine. This is about developing a knowledge base about alternative medicine and stuff like this, and things that are outside the medical mainstream. How to go about this? Well, I would recommend for starters to read my three books, on which cover my a variety of topics. But in addition to that, you need to make a list of all the topics that you might be interested in. There might be even 40 or 50 topics. And do private research on them. How does one research a topic? Well, Google it, look at the Wikipedia, look up the internet, pull out magazine articles. Magazine articles on things are fantastic because they have often got a lot of summarized information. Look up TED Talks, YouTube Talks on the matter, and research best-selling books on the subject and read them, at least some of what is of interest. And remember, best-selling books are best-selling for a reason. So if one can follow these things, one can become extremely well informed about any given topic in this day and age. So you can become a self-taught expert, okay? And now, once the basic course that I have proposed in these talks is really only to cover anxiety, stress, and depression. So once one has mastered the basics of doing this, one can graft anything onto this bit of knowledge. For example, things like alcohol abuse, substance abuse, PTSD, abuse issues, all kinds of stuff. And one can either become an expert in what one feels drawn to or interested in, or one has a personal stake in, or you can become an expert in a topic that may have commercial value to you in your area. For example, substance abuse. There may be a lot of substance abuse, or there may be a gap in the market for people that focus on, say, substance abuse. So, and you can capitalize on this in the way I've said. And finally, about becoming a self-taught therapist, don't ever let anybody tell you that you can't be an expert on a topic. So it does not matter if somebody is qualified, they've got formal qualifications or whatever. In this day and age, if you are interested in acquiring knowledge and go about it in the right way, it doesn't matter that you don't have qualifications. You can get to know more about a topic than any expert, because all the information and knowledge is out there on the internet, in books and things like this, and there's nothing to prevent you from becoming as expert as anybody else. So, and that's the end of the talk. And remember that if you go about it in the right way, you can do it. You really can. So, for people that have watched these talks, and one needs to mull it over and see if one is drawn into this. And things usually follow their own course, and people develop strategies for pursuing different things. And if this is the case, I do wish you luck. I'll be coming again, but that's only briefly in the next talk, in to give you some ideas about what I think, how people can communicate with me and things like this for any queries to do with my work. Okay, I'd like to conclude this talk series with my particular views on the management of mental health issues within society at large. And this is about comparing the medical model versus a social model of managing mental health on a bigger scale. If you look at the causes of poor mental health, the causes are by and large are primarily social. For example, you can get joblessness, job insecurity, people that have homelessness or home or rent insecurity. and various other associated difficult social circumstances and social problems that lead people to feel hopeless. Now, for whatever reason, all forms of severe mental disability mean that the person is financially inactive. And this means a huge financial cost to the state. So, in the cases of severe disability from whatever cause, it's the person has to be looked after by basically tax dollars or whatever. So, what is a way forward in looking at things on a more of a macro scale rather than a micro scale? I think it is to decrease the role of medical professionals in mental health policy, and increasing the role of people like social workers in mental health policy. Now, I want you to imagine something, just for imagination. Imagine you're looking at a macro situation. Now, take a population of something like 5 million people. That would be roughly, in the United Kingdom, the population of Scotland, or in the United States, the population of maybe the Colorado or South Carolina. Now imagine that, and you're looking at, imagine there was a group that was allocating funding to look after the mental health needs of such a big population. And we are looking here at billions of pounds or dollars or something like this, right? Now, imagine that you had, at the present time, in my opinion, mental health boards are overfilled with doctors, and if you put too many doctors in a situation, they will over medicalize. They will look for medical solutions to things. If you put in social workers, they will look at social ways of trying to deal with the issue and so forth. It depends what a person's perspective is. And as we have seen in all my talks, a lot of the management of mental health does not involve reaching out for a prescription pad or coming to some kind of medical diagnosis. It is really management of life situations such as anxiety, stress, depression, and so forth. Okay, coming back to this, imagine that you had 1/3 of the board was doctors. But not any doctors, but doctors that were experienced in either public health or had a particular, or had published papers on mental health, to do with public health policy or on a macro scale. It's quite important to understand that the training of doctors is such that a doctor's basic job description is to look after an individual patient. A doctor's job description does not involve involvement with groups of people as such. That is the work of public health and public health officials. So imagine that you had 1/3 doctors of this kind. You had 1/3 of people sitting on a board that were either social workers or people that were prominent in the health and well-being industry. And the third lot of people were politicians and health economists. After all, whatever plans you come up, they have to be in some way paid for. So the bottom line is, how do you pay for a system that you devise? How is it going to work financially? And unless the financial question can be answered or addressed, anything else is a waste of time. So, and it's important to understand that if you look at mental health from a social perspective, it is social workers are likely to come up with much better options, because for a social worker presented with a patient going through a difficult time, reaching out for a prescription pad is not an option of first choice. It is for a doctor, but not for a social worker. Now, and you can fund the training of 100 highly trained social workers for the cost that it would. You could train 50 doctors, and even these is just at a very basic level, because most of medical training is not to do with mental health, it's to do with other things. So it's quite important not to ask doctors to do things that they're not particularly trained in doing. So if you want to over-medicalize life, then you should hire doctors. If you want to find a more social way forward, then you should hire social workers to address the problem. Okay, that is the end of my spiel. I hope to put these talks on some kind of website. Now, I have chosen the name thelorenzomethod.com. I was trying to think of something to call my series, and I can, because I have devised something of a rather unique way of presenting a problem that is peculiar to me, I've had no option but to call it after myself, simply because I couldn't find any other words. So I bought the website. How I'll do it, I don't know, but it's thelorenzomethod.com. And I've asked a friend of mine to set up a group Facebook account called Lorenzo Method. So this is a method for disseminating these ideas. Now, I will be, obviously, depending on whatever happens to my to what I have, is I'd be more than happy to answer questions that anybody has about any aspect of my work or any aspect of anything in my books or audio-visual presentations or on my websites or anything like that. I'd be delighted to. But what I feel it would be really good to happen if I am to serve as some kind of contributing factor towards helping the mental health debate, if you like, on a bigger, on a different scale, is to actually help set up a kind of non-profit organization that can look at out-of-the-box thinking to do with how do you deal with mental health. And it is mainly looking at mental health from a social perspective. And it would require people that are suitably qualified, that can do various kinds of analyses, cost analyses, and various and develop various models that can be presented in a proper way to governments and people that organize things on a bigger scale. So it would be good to, you know, and they have to present statistics and things like this. And because unless you do that, everything boils down to money and the allocation of funds and how these funds are distributed, provided, and what is the remit of such groups. I hope these talks contribute to such a debate, and thank you for listening.